Yeah, I'm just going to launch the poll. I think we're going to give it a few minutes for people to rock up. And I've got I'm testing out a poll for tonight, so you can just start answering the poll. It's like a community poll thing. So I just realized for newcomers, it's not going to be easy to answer question four. Anyway, if you're smart, you can figure it out. So for everyone coming, joining now, just check out the poll and we'll start in a minute or two. I think we'll give it like 5 minutes. Can you guys see the poll?
Yeah, I can see it.
Yeah. Yeah.
No one's answering, is it?
Yeah, we can see it.
You can't see the answers as far as I understand. I mean, the like what other people are answering. Yeah, guys, if you're new or you haven't introduced yourself yet, please just let me know in the chat so that we can do that. A very important part. Is the poll just like not very fun, or is there a reason no one's answering?
It's hard, that's why.
Okay. I think it's a bit biased towards people who've been around for a while. Seems like we're having a little bit of an issue with people trying to join, not being able to log in. Did anyone experience that issue and then get it right?
Yeah, I had to. When I tried to join, it said that I'm unauthorized. I just created a new account on Zoom and then it worked. Like, it's weird.
It was asking me to log in into my Zoom account because it's only available to by invite only.
So it doesn't
work. If you don't have a Zoom account, then you can't get in.
Okay.
And I suppose the invite and the Zoom account has to be on the same email, I'm guessing.
Okay, let me see if I can fix this somehow. It's all the Investec peeps.
Yeah.
Is it an Investec issue, Shaw?
No, I'm on the network and still logging in. I think it's the guys that haven't had Zoom meetings with family and stuff that didn't register an account.
Yeah, if you're... we requiring people to sign in, otherwise it's very hard to track attendance.
Anyway, So while you're trying to sort out that, it's all quite a cool thing. The Twitter CEO coming out and saying all his staff can work from home forever. It's quite interesting.
Yeah. That's when they're on.
Welcome to the future. We also, I work at Vulcan Labs. We've gone fully remote now because of the whole COVID thing. We're looking at moving away from offices and just being a remote first company as well.
Yeah, we're the same at Advantage Learn. We've gone fully remote.
Okay, I think time's up. I'll leave the poll up. No one's answered it. No one's answered anything. Is it that hard?
I've answered stuff, so I don't know if it doesn't
is it not?
Go up. I've submitted it. I submitted the answers and everything.
Oh, okay. Okay, maybe it's just not showing up on my side. Alrighty, let's kick it off. I'm always a little bit scared to make this thing full screen. Let's give it a go. Cool. Can you see the agenda for tonight?
Yep.
Okay, cool. So pop quiz is running. I'll leave that running. I'm going to do some intros quickly just to see who's new in the community. Then I'm going to give a... We switched. Sorry, it says 1, 3, 2, 4 if you are... very observant. So we're going to go to the community demo with the decentralized API from Chris Muller, and then community update from my side. Ricardo asked this week, just like, why am I doing this? So it's hard. It's kind of hard to answer that question because we have some like big long-term vision for the project, but that's not really useful right now because we need to do a lot to get there. So I'm just going to talk through that, and then we will do Q&A and wrap up at the end. So just dive into any questions. Investec team is online tonight, so if you've got questions for the Investec team, just pop them a question. They're not going to be giving an update tonight. They're kind of doing the same stuff they did last week. They're planning to release a bunch of stuff next week, hopefully. All right, Ben, I think you are first up with your intro. So you can just say your name, where you work, one of your current most exciting projects, and kind of tech ideas that you're interested in playing with. Let's try to keep it down to 30 seconds per person. Otherwise,
cool.
Might run out of it.
Cool. So I'm Ben Janneke. I work at Vulcan Labs. What we're currently doing that's kind of cool is we're building a clone of Amazon S3 for a client, and that'll be released in the next 2 or 3 weeks. And I'm always interested in playing with Rust and React.
Thanks, Ben. Sorry, I'm just dealing with some other people who can't get on board. But cool. Hugs. Are you new? Also, who is Hugs? It just says Hugs. Can Hugs speak? No, Hugs is also not new.
Not new. I have to sign in. So I didn't want to use my actual
okay.
Email address.
Okay.
It's a guess. Just right. Easier that way.
All right, welcome, dude. Anyone else? Let me just check the list through the attendee list. You will not escape. Bernard, have you introduced yourself before?
No, I have not. I've been here for a while, but I'm Bernard. I work at Intersect. I'm the security architect there. Trying motivate the team to do things securely.
Cool, thanks. Johan Milan, have you introduced yourself?
I did last week.
Cool. Ricardo, have you introduced yourself? Sorry, I should keep a register of this. Ricardo is on mute. All right, I can't spot anyone else new, but
I'm new.
Are you new?
Hi.
Yeah. Krauss, I work at Be Online. We don't have too many exciting projects, but we work a lot with state machines. And yeah, give me some Rust and React, and I'm super stoked.
Okay, cool. Maybe you and Ben can partner up when we do that. On Rust. Cool. Chris, don't want to delay any further. It's over to you. So do you want to take it away? I'll share my, you can take over screen share.
Cool, thanks. Cool, guys. Yeah, thanks. Just before I jump in, so I joined this program about 4 weeks ago, and I've been, or maybe more than that, like 6 weeks ago or so. And I've kind of been moonlighting, because at work, just to keep up with work, so this has been moonlighting, so I really haven't given this as much time as I really wanted, but I have, my goal was to get it to a point where I had a decentralized API that I could use. So just shout if you can, well, let me actually keep this logged in. Just shout if you can see my screen.
Yeah.
Cool. Okay, so I work a lot with Laravel and Ortho. So those are my kind of go-to technologies. I really wanted to build a decentralized API, and what I mean by that is, so not just sending the transactions directly to a Firestore. I wanted to create an API where the transactions kind of went as a middle ground before they went to a Firestore database, so that you can manipulate what you do with the transactions before you go store them. So that enables you to do two things. Obviously, for the before transaction, it allows you to do a validation. So that's where the kind of Laravel API comes into play, where I can send the before transaction there, and off of whatever logic I define, I can decide whether or not to allow that transaction or not. We have that 2 second window to play with. And it seems to be working really well, and I'll go through some of the stuff I've been working with. And then with the after transaction, you can decide what to do before you store it. So I'm not just storing every transaction in kind of one go. I'm storing the simulation transaction separately to the real live transaction. So that's just an example of the opportunity of having a decentralized API. It is an authorized API, so I've used just the Ortho management API off of the programmable banking. So just to give you a quick look into this, I actually had a lot of issues with this just trying to get it to work initially. One of the guys really helped out. I think you're actually on the chat here. But in the end of the day, it actually ended up just being, I think it was a buggy issue with the actual platform, because the error was not anything to do with the APIs. It was just popping up here, and then one day it worked. I didn't change anything. It just started working. So yeah, I really wasn't sure. But essentially, the Ortho grabs a token, and then that it uses that token to make the API call. And then on the Laravel side, it checks the token using the same Ortho and validates that. So it's sending the data both before transaction to my Laravel APIs here. So I've got a validation API and I've got a transactions API. The validation API is a post call that receives back whether true or false, whether the authorization should be allowed or not. And then the transaction one just does a post sending the transaction to the Laravel side. So on Laravel, I got this app up here, which is just a basic Laravel app using Tailwind UI just to make it look relatively okay. And let me move this across here. This is just to show an example of what we can do when you have that kind of decentralized API where you can manage some logic outside of just storing the data, the transactions. So you can see here I've differentiated simulation and live transactions. So if I come in here and I simulate a transaction, and then I come back here. Oh, wait, that's not right. Here we go. So yeah, so there we go. Code is bar, that transaction just happened. So there's a simulation transaction. And I can show you, or I'll do a live transaction with my, I've got Zappy here. So I've just been doing some live transactions. But what I really want to demo on this is the abilities to now, because I have the API where I can kind of decide what to do with the before transaction. I can set transaction limits in my app. I can also block the card with my app. So I'm going to just block the card quick, do a save, and then I'm going to run an actual live transaction with Zapper. Got a Zapper code here for my flatmate. His deli, so he's very stoked. He's got a whole bunch of one rands. And so trying to make the payment. I don't know if you guys can see anything. And that was successful because I hadn't saved it. So now let's, if I refresh this, should show at the bottom here the latest payment. This is where I've been having some issues, is that the live transactions haven't always been coming through on the after transaction. I don't know why. But it only seems to be when I'm logged in on this side that it seems to be much more finicky with the live transaction. So I'm just gonna try that again. Try another one rand. And there it got blocked. So because I've created the block of the card, the live transactions aren't working. And if I unblock that, the live transaction will come through again. So I'll try it once more with it unblocked. See if it comes through. Okay, it was successful. Yeah, and they came through. So you can see how the two simulations, the live and the simulation transactions, are getting separated out. Not because of a data parameter, just because they're being stored in different collections in Firestore, based on whether they're simulation or live. And then with the transaction limits here on the blocking card, I can actually block the transactions before they go. So if, I mean, obviously you can do this in the Investec app. You can go in and block your card, but if I didn't want to do that, I could come and block my card in here. And I guess the use cases around this outside of like setting transaction limits and that, because I'm pretty sure you can do that in the Investec app. But an example I thought of is if I'm going out drilling and I want to set a limit for the day of 1,000 rand. And I don't want to spend that if I get too excited at the draw, especially if I'm out with the Hank guys. I know they go pretty hard. So you can set a limit here, and then if you reach, you can kind of track the transactions. And if you reach that limit that day, you can block your any further transactions. And then I could come into this app and have to update that limit. You could also limited to certain merchant categories. So I could set the initial to only allow transactions that are forward from bakeries or from general services, or I could set it to after 2 a.m. in the morning to only allow me to catch Ubers and buy McDonald's. So yeah, I guess the benefit of having the kind of not just sending all transactions straight to a Firestore is allows you to have that kind of control of what you do before the transaction, and so yeah, and then after transaction data, you can store that data and use that data to then influence what you do with the before transaction. Short and sweet. So I hope that made sense.
Yeah, that's really cool, man. I love it. I'm starting to think more about this idea of just having quick access, like a kind of no login bank app type thing that you can lock your, like do things like stop your card, see your balance, see transactions, like things that you maybe aren't that necessary to protect if you don't want to protect them. I'd love to have a second bank app where you can just like get quicker access to things.
I think my goal here would be to build out a mobile app. Obviously you don't want to be limited to just a desktop app. This is actually, I'm hosting this on Forge, so it is available, but it is guarded with the author login. So I can actually use this right now if I'm out and about and I want to log in and block my card. It is usable.
Sweet. Any questions from the audience?
I have a question. That one of those transactions that you marked for that got rejected, does the payment process or anything, do they just get a generic rejection, or are you able to actually send something to them to say why it was rejected?
I just get a, because it actually doesn't come through at all after the rejection. So on the after transaction, I don't see anything coming through. So on the Zapper app, it just says declined.
But from their perspective, that merchant, I think, would be able to see. I actually work at Zapper, so I'll go check out what it shows there. Okay. But I'm interested to see if you would be able to control that.
Yeah, I don't think on our side right now with the API, you can just return false. You can't give a message. You can't return false.
That was what the Investec guy said they were working on a few weeks back.
Okay.
The ability to actually pass the message through to say why it was rejected. And you'd also get it if it was rejected before getting to you, kind of thing. So like incorrect PIN or insufficient funds or whatever.
Yeah, and so also interesting to note is another issue with the simulations is if I block it, let's say I change it or transaction limits at 100. If I come here and I make it 150 and I simulate it, it will come here as false. So authorization approved is false. But then if I come here, the transaction actually gets stored anyway. So you can see the transaction there. So even though it's false on the simulations, they still come through. But if they don't come through for the real life transactions.
Yeah, so there's a bit of alignment we have to do on our side, just in terms of the simulating the transaction in terms of like declining and a production one. So production one kind of tries to hook into a method that used to be there that we've talked about a bit before. But for the new guys, it tries to like hook into like a after decline method, which we've removed. But we did it a bit like prematurely. So one of our other devs, Ernst, has been working on actually getting that proper response, decline response, like the guy was saying, incorrect PIN, the client blocked it, i.e. in this case, like blocking the card. So terms of that, the card team is done with their side. So I think we endeavor at the moment, Ernst?
They are still making changes to it. It's not in dev yet. But it should be before the end of this week, they said. So we should have it by tomorrow.
Yeah, and then so we're still in change freeze. So probably in about a week, we can give you guys an update there.
Okay, awesome. Any other questions?
Charles, you asked any reason why not Lumen? Is that for Chris?
I didn't use Lumen because I actually had it on Lumen originally, and that's what I posted. But I just wanted to use Ortho, and if I was using this to just speak to another mobile app or something, I could have stuck on Lumen. But I just wanted some extra functionality that came with Laravel, and the performance difference just really didn't warrant staying on Lumen. I just went straight with Laravel. I just upgraded it actually.
Cool. Anything that like kind of surprised you when you did this that you didn't expect? Like anything that you kind of learned by doing this or that was interesting?
The Firebase authentication was quite a challenge. I ended up making it work with just the ENV files. I'm not using the fireservice.json. I managed to get it to, I can control everything from the .env, so I am able to get it's quite a complex tutorial because there's so many parts. There's Ortho, there's Firebase service authentication. So I do aim to get it up and onto a repo that's publicly available and put up a tutorial for guys who are interested, but it will require, I mean, everything's free except for the, yeah, you could even host this on Heroku or something for free. So the author is free, the Firestore is free, and Heroku is free. So you could actually do it all for free, but it would require quite a bit of effort. But I do plan to get it up. But yeah, the Firestore authentication is quite a mission.
Cool. And in terms of like upcoming features or maybe not upcoming features from the platform side, what are you kind of most looking forward to?
I think at the moment it's being able to, as the Hank guys last week were discussing, the ability to get the actual Vestic users to be able to like use this. So I could give people an API key that they could hit this with and log in with their own accounts. And at the moment I can do it by, if you guys create an account and then I actually wrote in your account number and then you inject the code into your side. But it's quite a mission. So I think until we get to the point where other people can use the stuff we are building, it's all going to be quite siloed, where we're all just kind of working on things ourselves.
And do you feel like this might have any applications or anything that you could do with programmable banking? You might have applications in your company or in your business, or is that not really something you're thinking about yet?
Not really in our company at the moment. We're an online education company, so there's not really a need to kind of limit people's daily transactions or anything like that. I guess just from a from an insights view of the feed coming in, would be cool. But we get that from the guys anyway, so not much from our business.
Okay. Cool. Any other questions? Does the guitar come off the wall?
It does, but it's my flatmate, and all he knows how to play is Happy Birthday. So unless it's someone's birthday today, it's going to stay on the wall.
Is it someone's birthday? Come on. Okay. All right. Thanks, Chris. That's really awesome.
Okay.
Love it. And looking forward to seeing what you kind of do next with it.
Cool.
Checking there's no more questions. Cool. I'm going to bounce back to the slides. Ricardo just raised this question earlier. I think he was new since last week. So he spent a bit of time getting his own solution, but he's like, keeps questioning himself, why am I doing this? Like, where is this all going? Will it eventually be possible for non-dev/beta participants to make use of some of these solutions? And can we get a magic one-click deploy? So I'm going to do the standard diplomatic thing and answer the broader context question. This is a slide which came up. These two slides came up in our kind of strategy session. We do a bi-weekly strategy session with Investec. And I think it just kind of, it's easier to just tell you what we're thinking of in terms of strategy at the moment. Like, really, we kind of put together the IDE toward in like the second half of last year over a 2-day hackathon with Investec, got it up and running, and then kind of in February, we kind of ironed out all the kinks to start onboarding people who weren't internal to Investec or OfficeIn. So we've just kind of been focusing on the next step so far. That's not to say that there aren't like big dreams and long-term goals and stuff, but you know, you can only spend so much time talking about those things, and you have to just kind of do the next thing. You guys kind of define what the next thing is by your GitLab issues and just by raising it in these demos and stuff. So thanks, Chris. Thanks to the HANCAP guys last week for just like highlighting what is the most kind of burning issue at the moment and where you guys are thinking. My watch is going off. So basically our thinking is you can't, top left, like you can't predict exactly what structure and mechanisms this ecosystem will favor. If we had sat down, we would have created a certain roadmap. And then as soon as people start using it, they kind of start asking for things that you didn't think of. So we're trying not to force that and more just like create opportunity, observe what people go after, what people try and do with the thing, and then be ready to move when that becomes apparent. It's easy to say, hard to do sometimes. So if you guys are asking if you can onboard investor clients right now, that's pretty hard to do. So so there's that. Another thing we just kind of have learned from previously launching Root a few years ago is that there was a sandbox when we launched Root, and that just created a lot of noise in the community, and like a lot of people messing around with very low commitment to what they're actually doing. So that's why we don't have kind of a sandbox for the open community, because it just creates a lot of noise. So the stages for kind of maturity of this project, as we see it, is getting committed devs to build things for themselves inside the IDE. We're working on the NPM module, or Charles working on it, so that you'll be able to push your code from your local environment. And Willem's working really hard, has been working super, super hard for quite a while now on the statement API, so that you can pull your bank balances and your bank account, your transactions and stuff from your bank account. And then you can see all your EFTs, not only your card transactions. Cool. So once you've got kind of devs committed and building stuff for themselves, then we're hoping that we see devs, dev teams building niche applications for their companies, because therein lies kind of business value. And then that should kind of evolve into, so what we've done at OfficeN is we've built a company application for ourselves that gives each person a company, we can give each person a company card, and we can see the spend on that card in a Google Sheet. Each person has their own Google Sheet. You can see the spend, and then you can tell the person you can like spend this much on books and this much on services and learning courses and that, and, you know, travel, if you need to travel to Joburg, that kind of stuff. I mean, obviously it's, a lot of that has changed due to lockdown. And then we're hoping the next phase is like companies are kind of hiring dev houses to build what they want. So if another company sees what we have and they say, we also want that, then they hire a dev house to use the programmable banking tools to build similar solutions for their own companies. And then as those dev houses build those kind of apps for companies and solve business problems, they can reuse what they build and sell it to other companies. So that's where we came into this. That kind of aligns as well with, I think, adding value in a, it's, I think that a lot of people seem to be thinking along the lines of, I'm going to do a consumer play, like SnapScan, Zapper, direct to consumer. Like that's very risky and very hard. So this is a more kind of sound progression in terms of adding value. And breaking it down into chunks that you can kind of consume. Not to say that we shouldn't be enabling that either. There's just also this kind of progression out there. And not to say that we won't pivot to that. It's just like sharing what we were kind of thinking and what we learned from Root. So we, at Root, they enabled, they kind of followed this 1, 2, 3, 4 progression, and now they are growing really fast, even during COVID, and they have large enterprise companies using their platforms. They didn't do a direct to consumer play. So this is just kind of a more story form of what I'm saying. So the idea is to inspire and support developers to build an app for a niche problem in their company using investor programmable banking. That would go along the lines of a beta community member goes to financial needs in an organization, creates a proof of concept. She demos that to her boss, and then the business opens up like an investor programmable banking account so that they can build that app. And then hopefully that would kind of, one, create opportunities for developers within that company, and two, enable that company to solve other companies' problems so it could become like a new product. So this is like a story or a version of the story, which I think might not be super apparent to the community. The kind of more obvious apparent route to world domination is just like build that consumer app, which is awesome. So I just wanted to share this with the community, like this is the other way that we're thinking. You can also at the moment use a business banking account. So you can open up a business banking account in addition to your private bank account. You can add multiple cards on that account. So on the OfficeZen account, we have 7 cards and you can program every single one of those cards. So I think for now, if you're like starting to try and think of how you can solve a business's problem, that's maybe like you could give a business kind of a card dashboard where they could limit spending controls and stuff, and you could order a bunch of cards. They would need an invested bank account. I kind of just took a stab at that. The actual answer that I gave to Ricardo in Slack was, we've got an idea of having an Investec Connect kind of marketplace of apps where clients can download apps built by the Bates community as a long-term goal. We've got this thing of building apps for businesses and helping developers to kind of do that for their own businesses and for other businesses as a long-term goal. And we're going to be keeping our ear to the ground in terms of what's going on in the community and taking the steps that we think are going to get us towards it, empowering like devs to do that. So right now that's the NPM module, that's the transactions API. Once we have an API across the line, hopefully we can open up more APIs in like shorter timelines. I don't know if anyone has questions or feedback. Ricardo, can you maybe define that question a bit? Or
sure. I mean, you just shared the idea of the Trojan horse approach. So I'm just curious. I mean, I can show my boss. You'll love this. But obviously, you know, it's just me playing around in my own programmable banking. So, I mean, if there's something that says OfficeZen or Investec behind it, some official material to just share with them, I think they might be interested. Our dev team is big. We've got like 70 guys in product development, product engineering. That's not even the full dev team. That's just product engineering. So, yeah, a lot of people might be interested in this.
Okay. That's great to hear because our thinking was the solution which we have in OfficeZen right now is a little bit blocked. We can make it work, but it's a little bit blocked by not having access to the API. So we're kind of waiting till the API gets released. And then we wanted to put together a kind of like a promotional video of what you can do with the thing. So that might be useful to you. But I think maybe also just a slide deck. But thanks, that's a good idea. Any other questions around this, or does this seem stupid, or does it seem smart, or don't you know?
What about the sort of what to call it, but the sort of like individual devs that are working on it, where their company might not have a need for it. So, like, you know, where like my company wouldn't have a need for this, you know, in the near future. But I'm still keen to play with it and build something significant out of it and, you know, make something and go somewhere with it.
Let me ask for you personally, like out of the narratives that we've kind of put down, what is kind of the most exciting for you? Is it the consumer play one or is it something else?
It's almost, I would say almost a hybrid between the consumer play or something like, guys within the community coming together and building something and potentially putting that out there.
Yeah.
You know, like the Hank guys have started something and then maybe seeing other demos and then bringing people together that way. For saying, okay, we don't need to now reinvent the wheel to build this particular part of this app and it'll really help our app. You know, can we pull them together and potentially build something out of that? That's one idea. Not sure if there's more, but yeah.
I mean, we were actually talking about this on Slack, you and I, just for everyone's for the sake of defining who
clarity is. And
yeah, we were talking about this earlier this week of like pooling all transactions in a database, anonymizing them, and then enabling like the whole community to build machine learning models around it, create insights, and just actually playing around. Because I think you're onto something there in terms of, I don't know if I'm maybe misreading what you're saying, but I think there is also something to be said for just playing around and just like messing around and building like weird things, because that's also often where, you know, things that kind of you never thought of, like I had this idea before, long before we actually launched the thing, where you have circle, you could like tag yourself, like I'm a surfer and I like reading books or something, or I like books, and then I see what other surfers, how much are other surfers spending, or how much are other, let's say my job title is community manager. I could tag myself as a community manager and then see where do I spend in comparison to other community managers, and what do I earn in comparison to other community managers by pooling all of my data into this like kind of sea of information. I don't know if that's a cool idea, but there's another, and Adam Fisher also raised this, of just creating like a community project where everyone can contribute a piece of code. So those sound really cool. They're like, I think I'm yet to really see one of those things work or take off, but I think if we can build something together, that's also like a really cool avenue. And that could maybe create like the kind of opportunities which Investec, for instance, can't create. Like Investec can't pool everyone's transactions and expose that to you. But if we get people to opt into that, we can kind of do that. Sorry, I kind of went off topic. Agustin, did you have a question around that, or?
Yeah, so that was kind of the question, and then you kind of answered it as well. Like, how do you guys see that playing out, or where do you see that playing out in terms of the guys who aren't in the position to say, let me go to my boss or whatever the case is and say, hey, look at this cool thing, and I think we can build this app, or what can we and get buy-in there, but rather are spending their time sort of off the books, as it were. Trying to build something that's, you know, in a completely different direction from what they might be doing day to day, or and like, you know, how do we nurture that?
So I was just trying to figure out as well what that the third thing I answered Ricardo this week was, and there's also this thing of like building financial systems. So it doesn't need to be an app which you see on your phone. So I hope you guys can see the blog right now, but there's a story on the blog of Symptom Bile from Eastern Cape. So that's him down in the middle there. He came to our like original Root hackathon, and he took the Root card back. And I think back at WSU, I think it was. Sorry, I don't know the story so well. But basically what he did was he combined three cards that people got with bursary funds loaded on them. And they had one card for spa, one card for like clicks, and another card for somewhere where they could spend their bursary money. And he combined them all into a single card and just gave everyone a single card at the university. So you don't necessarily need to have like a UI and an app. You can maybe build systems like this and hook up with the likes of bursary funds or institutions. I know I've spoken to me at in the Office and Foundation. So she's working with like mentors. If any of you guys are interested in mentoring marginalized, sorry, I'm not using my words well tonight, but not well represented people in technology, then check out Foundation Office and you can mentor. But we're thinking of like maybe giving each person in Foundation a spend card and enabling then people who want to empower people to spend by funding those accounts. So those are the kind of systems that you can also propose. Like SASA is basically just a card that has limits on it. And with this infrastructure, you can build those kind of systems. SASA's, a massive multi-billion rand operation and does a lot of good in South Africa, getting money out to people that really need it. So there's also those kind of things to think around here. Let me just check. Robin, we would need an account for the company to start using it at work. That could be a limit getting this proof of concept into companies we work for. Yes, that is a limitation. Yes, you would need to have an Investec account or Investec company account. Maybe start with a proof of concept on your own account and try that out if you can. I don't know if you have anything to add to that, Robin, if you're online. say about that? Not speaking. Robert's second rule might get in the way of integrating with many different services at the same time. Is there any plan to have a non-blocking before or after transaction? No return. Shaul, do you have an answer for that one?
Sorry, what was it again?
The second rule might get in the way of integrating with many different services at the same time. Is there any plan to have a non-blocking before slash after transaction? No return. That's from Robert in the chat.
Oh shit! Sorry, Ernst. I don't know if you caught it. Sorry, I was busy with the production incident, debugging something. So I'm just trying to catch up on the thing.
Yeah, the 2 second limitation is actually enforced by Visa. It's not something that we control. So there's, at this stage, from our side at least, not anything we can do about that.
Okay, sorry. So there from Robert. So essentially we could have something where if you don't return anything, it would just continue as normal. And then only if it returned false would it block a transaction, because it's a Boolean. It's either true or false. I mean, if it's true, we don't really care. We just allow it through. So we maybe could do something like that.
So, sorry to interrupt, but what would happen right now if I ran a promise without awaiting it and that function exits? Would that code still be spinning and finish running, or will that thread be killed?
No, it will still finish. It's essentially Visa needs a response in 2 seconds. If they don't get it, they proceed as normal. But if you've got a long-running function, it would finish.
Sweet.
Dave Saunders, is Naked Insurance based off the Root platform? As far as I know, there's no connection there. But Naked Insurance is awesome. I use them. You can put your car into like parked mode and only pay 30 rand a month on your app. I think that's fucking cool. And it's cheap AF, indeed. All right, I don't want to keep you guys any longer. I think we kind of covered things. It's been 45 minutes. Thank you, Chris, for that epic demo. Thanks for all the hard work there. Thanks, guys, for your patience on the releases. Hopefully some exciting updates next week. And thanks for coming back and just keeping this thing going. It's quite a big task we've set ourselves here. We're going to unlock banking infrastructure. That's no small task. I really hope to see a bunch of you back here next week. If you are new and you didn't introduce yourself next week, please introduce yourself and have a great weekend and peace. Last chance to say something if you got something you want to say. Chris, good to see you. Cool. Cheers, peeps.
Cheers, cheers.
Cheers, cheers.
Cheers, Shotgun. All done, Chris.
Cool. Ciao, everyone. Cheers, Ben. Thanks.
Ciao.